Hello, and welcome to the Writer's Nexus. Today I'm speaking with author Cyan, author of the book Girl Fighter. Tell me a little bit about this, about your writing process, how you got to the point where you wanted to write a novel before we dive into Girl Fighter. I'd like to know a little bit more about your background in terms of writing and publishing and all that. I'd love to hear that.
Okay, so it started, I suppose, many years ago. In case it's not really obvious, I actually learned English, well, when I was 6 years old, so it wasn't my first language. But I was educated in English in school, and until when I was a teenager, I don't think I was ever that good in English. And it caused me a bit of problem in school, and I guess that would set off the determination of trying to improve the language.
Where are you from?
I was born in Asia.
Okay.
And I did go to university in England, and that's how I got to know the ins and out of the UK quite well.
Okay.
So when I went to the UK, I think I encountered a fair bit of life-changing experiences, and I wanted to write about it. And just in trying to improve my language, I started to write sort of like a blog, because when I went to England, blogs didn't really quite exist. And I just wrote them and sent to my families and friends to read. And at the beginning, most of them just commented on how the language ability has improved. But over time, they start to see a development in style and enjoy what I wrote. And then I started to travel quite a lot in my life, nearly 100 countries in my lifetime. And I wrote about my experience in where I visited and the people that I met along the way. And it seems to intrigue people a lot. And then, you know, the idea came about people asking me to write about the experiences I had in my travels, which is interesting because this has been occurring over a time span of 20 years. I have tried to write about an experience I had in Ecuador about 15 years ago because I had a very serious accident, but that never quite came to fruition. I think I tried to write, but I couldn't really somehow compile it into a book that was that, I don't know, had a beginning at the end or had a strong subject or a strong message. So I sort of abandoned that quite shortly. But I think in my mind, I've always wanted to write a story that describes the many stories that encompasses many stories I've experienced in my life. Not in a direct way of documentary style, or because I find that it's in general less, it doesn't bring the message across as successfully as if you have packaged the whole experience into a series of little stories. And I think people seem to like being told a story a bit better than being watching a documentary, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
So that's how it all came about. And therefore, one fine day, about 4 years ago, I came up with this idea and I really liked it. I started to research on it. And this time, I actually did find a lot more, much more, the story was a lot more comprehensive, and I was able to pack it together nicely into the neat compartments I have in the book. And several years later, it came out. That's how it came about. Really.
Great. So is this your first book that you've published?
Yes, it's the first book that I've written and the first book that I've published.
All right. Wow, that's interesting. So you said you've been traveling for 20 years. Can I get your age or an age range?
I'm just shy, a year shy of 40, or a few months shy of 40. Actually, I've been traveling more than 20 years, but on my own about 20 years, but with family probably close to most of my life, I think left country first. So I've been traveling a fair bit, and I think I do like to observe and integrate as much as I can as a tourist, and open my eyes up to how the world is different from my past experience, and try and learn from everyone else. And that's why I thought writing a very good avenue for me to express all these thoughts that I have.
Okay. All right, well, then that brings us to Aliyah, the lead character in Girl Fighter. And I got to say, she was not really what I was expecting, and really not like anything that I've seen in a novel or on screen anywhere. She was a really interesting character. You end up rooting for her really strongly, yet you've written her in a way that is very clear. She doesn't have a lot of friends or family. She's very much alone in the world, but also extremely strong and independent. So I think in a lot of ways, she would resonate with a lot of women, even if they don't do combat sports or anything like that. But there's something in her spirit that really kind of resonated with me. And I tend to think that women are much more independent anyway than men, no matter what it looks like on the outside. So I found her to be infinitely fascinating. I'd love to know how you arrived at this particular character, because she's got, you know, an interesting background. She's multiracial, and she's a fighter plus a computer programmer. So, you know, it's really an interesting mix. So if you could, expand on how you came up with Aliyah, I would love to hear that.
Okay. Well, to explain why I came up with her, I have to briefly explain how I came up with this book, or the overall writing principle I had when I was writing this book, and I try to keep that in mind throughout the entire book. So my ambition as a writer is to write about subject matters that are under or misrepresented in society, I suppose more misrepresented. And when I came up with this idea of this book, the two core subject was martial arts. I wouldn't necessarily say mixed martial arts, but just martial arts in general, or combat sport athlete, and also brain injury, or anyone who suffered invisible injury. So with that two in mind, then I needed a character that could bring across this two quite well. So the first part, as an athlete or as a combat sport athlete, I think generally when somebody says, oh, he's a fighter or she's a fighter, the first few adjectives that come to mind is aggression, or probably not had to use their brawn, not their brains, for work. Mm-hmm. And also angry. And yes. Then the second aspect of invisible injury is most people view them as, a very simplistic way. Like I said, the adjective is usually they're crazy, or they are a bit weird, or they are antisocial, but not actually realizing that deep inside they do have the same desires and wishes, but for whatever reason in their lives they didn't manage to engage or have meaningful bonds as you would as a person who didn't undergo any form of psychiatric disorders, whether it's a brain trauma or mental health issues.
Right.
So with all of that in mind, you know, how do I confront, or how do I had to create a character that was anti all of these adjectives. Mm-hmm. So the first part of it was she has to be very intelligent, as opposed to somebody who is a muscle man. You know, right. She's actually not just intelligent, but has an extraordinary high IQ, works in technology.
Right.
And then, of course, she's female, and that also contradicts the cliché view of a fighter, always a man. Mm-hmm. Until recently, anyway, it is actually more or less, it's not just a male-dominant sport. It's a male-dominant sport now, but until a few decades ago, it's actually a male-exclusive sport. You don't see any women in it at all. So, In that way, she contradicts most of the adjectives that everyone thinks of when they think of a fighter. Mm-hmm. And therefore, I thought, okay, first she needs to be very clever, and she needs to be a she. Mm-hmm. And also, as far as martial arts is concerned, I find in general the Far East, he's in a way very developed, but in the style of martial arts. But in modern day, because say China, for example, which is one of the most advanced or varied in the development of martial arts over the last few centuries, is underrepresented in the mainstream sports because they have had other issues over the several decades, and now they're just starting to come back to mainstream sport, which is strange because they have a very strong history. And therefore, I mentioned the race of Chinese/Kazakh and even vaguely Mongolian, because they're very big wrestlers and extremely integrated into their culture for centuries, not just recently. So that's how I came about, you know, cherry picking what I want and then, you know, gradually merging into one character. And similarly with mental illness, what I have found when I was doing the research on treatment with whether it's an actual physical trauma, head trauma, or an internal injury such as whether it's, like I said, mental health issues or acquired disorder. The treatment, unfortunately, all seems to rely heavily on observation and the contribution of their family and friends to discuss what they've observed in the behavior of the person who suffered from it. So the first thought that came to my mind is, what if she has no friends? What if she has no family? What if this person has absolutely no one to observe her? How does she get treated? So that's kind of why I came up with the character that has to address all these issues that I want to discuss and challenge the misconception of it, if that makes sense.
Yes. Yes, I think it does. It's interesting. Some of the interactions that you write about what she has, how she interacts with men, and some of them felt uncomfortably familiar, both in the workplace and in her personal life. So I kind of felt like that was almost like it was very revealing in a lot of ways. So in a personal way. I understand. I can see how you got in all the issues, like sort of the cultural or societal issues in her character. I'm curious as what kind of agenda that you may have had on a personal note, because her relationships with men were just so, and how you reveal her thinking process through that as a woman. It's like, wow, it's like that's a little too familiar. So can you speak about how you came up with that?
Well, I have to say I'm very happy that you feel that way, because the interesting thing is, as I mentioned, I have traveled a fair bit in my life. Mm-hmm. And I've encountered, I don't know if it's a dirty word nowadays, discrimination or marginalization in my life through mm-hmm. other reasons. But I find that it doesn't actually necessarily matter how you are marginalized or why you are marginalized. Except that people who are ostracized in society tend to feel the same way. So I realized it doesn't actually matter the reason, or say, you know, this person is Chinese, that person is African American, this other third person is Arabic, and now they're not particularly right. popular. Or I'm not saying they're not right now, but say, for example, facing their life, they weren't. And it wouldn't matter at all what race they were or why they were marginalized. Maybe they were poor or they weren't good looking enough, but how they shared their experience are generally similar, which is which is what I was about to explain. Say, if I want to accuse someone, you're racist, you weren't very good to me, or you're sexist, and people tend to think of that as it's a fairly how should I say, it's not a very neat word, if that makes sense. And it's interesting right now, the whole explosion of Harvey Weinstein and et cetera, yes. and company. Yes. What happened is, you know, when you want to write a headline, you want to write, right, so-and-so actually sexually harassed me on day ABC and such and such time. Mm-hmm. People want to know the specifics. But the problem is, it's not usually very neat. What happened is it happens over a progressive period of time. I can't say, right, he sexually harassed me because he said he liked the look of my breasts, for example, because people would just say, well, can't you take a joke? But right. it generally isn't a one-off incident. It's accumulated over a period of time through a variety of behavior that make you realize this person is not very good to you, for example. Mm-hmm. So therefore, it was necessary, and I'm very, that's why, I mean, I'm very glad that you felt that it was familiar, even though you might not have encountered the exact same experience.
Right.
But I think the sense of familiarity comes from how you were dismissed to go, I felt so-and-so colleague wasn't very good to me. And then I ask you why, and you go, oh, on day one, he called me this, on day two, he called me that. And then I said, mm-hmm. individually, it'll sound very don't sound like such a huge deal. Why are you being so sensitive, you know? And right. you find that, how is it that I'm being blamed for this instead?
Right. right.
So I think everyone who has been marginalized, you're exactly the same. So it didn't matter mm-hmm. what this so-and-so has said to you on day one and two and three and 100. What right. matters is how you are unable to articulate why specifically you feel you've been, for example, discriminated or ostracized or harassed.
I couldn't agree with you more. I think that's absolutely right. I have seen the same thing in my own life. It doesn't, if you don't feel included, if you feel pushed to the margins. It doesn't matter what you look like, who you are. You could be like a mainstream looking white guy, you know, but if there's something in your personality or some sort of quirk that you have that has made people sort of shun you, there, yes, you're correct in the sense that it does sort of create a kind of characteristics in a personality where you're forced on the edge.
Yes.
So I thought you captured that brilliantly. So it was a little difficult to read. What I loved about this character is that she was so complex, and there were so many reasons sort of not to root for her or not to continue finding out about her life, but she just kept fighting on the outside and on the inside. And even though you could see there were like 1,000 reasons why somebody wouldn't want to get close to her or take advantage of her, she kept pushing through. And so I have to, you know, it made me wonder about the author, somebody who would create a character like this. So, you know, I guess I'm curious also, you've told us a lot about your traveling. That is certainly an unusual thing in today's society, to a certain extent. Not too many people travel for 20 years almost constantly. But also the fighting aspect, the training, the actual scenes within the fights, I kind of felt like I was right in there with Aliyah taking those punches. I had to think that you must have spent hours in the ring. I mean, you just have to. If you didn't, then it's remarkable what you've done. So please let me in on that secret, because that was awesome.
Again, I'm very happy you felt that, because I can admit straight away I've never been in a cage,
or you haven't.
In a cage fight. The furthest I've ever, well, you can say the highest level I've ever, how should I say, succeeded or achieved in combat sport is I have fought as an amateur boxer. So
okay.
That's traditional boxing, but not mixed martial arts, which to me is a completely different league. Well,
yes.
I shouldn't say that, because I think that undermines the traditional boxers. But to me, it's a rather different sport. I would have liked to gone in cage fighting, but I think by that point I was a little bit tired physically and age-wise. Again, I don't really want to say that, because I know fighters who are older than me and still very successful. I suppose you can say, similar to what I wrote about, whether it's gender discrimination or being ostracized because of your race or your quirkiness or your illness, what the creation composes of is, in some ways, my personal experience, in some ways, my observation of what other goes through and what people have shared with me. And through the important part, I suppose, is through the lack of judgment. I don't want to say, so-and-so told me their experience. I don't want to tell them, you are feeling this way because of such and such, and this is my opinion of how you feel like that. But instead, actually just weave it into a story and let someone else have their own opinion. But what I guess required was a whole lot of imagination and try and string my own experience. Maybe say, for example, I did mention I was a boxer, so I had been punched in the head a lot. So I just tried to amplify that by, okay, if I got punched in the head, how would that feel if I got punched in the ribs, or if I got kicked in the ribs, or if I was twisted into a pretzel? You know, just try and imagine how that would feel based on the one experience I have been punched a lot. I have trained in a whole variety of martial arts, so it's not the imagination part wasn't too hard, in the sense that I have been twisted into a pretzel before, and I have been kicked, and I have been abused. Well, I wouldn't call it abuse, but I have been attacked in more ways than one during training, not outside training. Fortunately, not outside training so far physically. But as I was mentioning, I did have real-life experience. My experience of an actual tournament is through my tournament experience as a boxer. Mm-hmm. And I sort of just try and string the tournament experience to the other training experience and weave it into one fight scene. And also, okay, I have seen a fair number of tournaments in my life, you know, just watching the expression and watching what happens after and listen to what they say on social media afterwards. And using a bit of imagination and just trying to weave it all into a story.
It worked. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Those fight scenes are really potent, really potent. And it just sort of kind of gains momentum, because in the beginning she's just sparring with somebody else at the gym, and then she gets into actual fights, and it kind of, the whole intensity starts to ramp up with more of the fight scenes. So yeah, you really did a great job there. After she has her an accident, there is some medical treatment she needs to get. Again, that felt very real. How much experience in the medical field or in hospitals do you have?
I have been actually in the hospital many times in my life, not through head trauma, fortunately, not good. I had a severe back accident about 15 years ago, and I was hospitalized. And actually, I won't go into the details. It will take me too long to describe all my hospitalized experience. But so far, I mean, it hasn't caused any permanent long-term damage. So I wrote about her hospital experience through my own experience. Again, as I said, adding a touch of imagination. The other part, as I was saying earlier, I find it doesn't matter whether it's a physical trauma or acquired injury, but most things related to the head. Unfortunately, the current imaging technology that we have, this is just my idea through the research I've done. I'm not a neurosurgeon or a neurologist, and definitely not a doctor. So I need to put that disclaimer right in front. It's just through my own research of the science that I can't seem to find any extremely conclusive diagnostic method for any brain or head related illnesses or disorders. And that's how I came about with the idea is, and I have known someone who, how should I say, escaped psychiatric treatment from just saying, I feel great. And then I thought, I'm sure this story is not new. And again, because we've heard of people who took off from psychiatric disorder, psychiatric facilities, and then subsequently committed suicide, etc. Things, stories like that. And it also led me to think how easy or difficult it is to avoid treatment just because you want to, you don't want to be treated, or you don't want to be treated differently. You want to go back to your life.
Right.
But at the same time, there isn't anyone to observe you or look out for you or report your symptoms back to medical facilities. And sometimes even if you have someone to observe you or look out for you, they may be limited in what they can do because they're not with you 24/7.
Right.
So I actually I joined quite a lot of forums for brain injury survivors. And I read a lot of feedback from either survivors or caregivers. And I found it doesn't matter how they got the brain injury or disorder, it's quite varied how they came to that point. But what there are some similarities that underline all of them, which is they are usually quite tired, angry, and also upset about how people view them differently. So they do their very best to hide all the three symptoms. If there was a more accepting, if there was more acceptance in society, they might have more hope of recovering, because if they embrace their injury and try to treat it better, but instead they're trying to hide it because they're ashamed or they're embarrassed or they get a lot of negative behavior as a result of brain trauma or injury. So I find that personally quite discouraging, and therefore I wanted to try and give them a voice. And I have had close friend and family, not some of them are from a long time ago. I remember I have a classmate when I was very young, and she was bipolar, or subsequently diagnosed bipolar. But the struggle she'd gone through before she was formally diagnosed and treated was quite heartbreaking for me at that point. But I was quite helpless because I was very young. I didn't know how to help her. And I guess that stayed with me in a way. And I've also have known people with schizophrenia and anxiety disorder and even autism. So,
well, it just sounds like this book has been very cathartic for you on a number of different levels. Do you feel that it was not really therapeutic, but cathartic is the word that really comes to mind? It sounds like it has been for you on a number of levels. Is that, would you say that's accurate?
I suppose, yes. Because I think going back to how we were discussing why I started to write, or why I wanted to write, start with, was because you know, you go through these things in life and you have, you know, deep, profound thoughts. Okay, maybe not deep, profound thoughts, or you think about it a lot and it stays with you for whatever reason. And you really want to let it out. But, you know, if I go out on a pedestal and start yelling, all of you treat brain injuries, people better. And it's not really going to work. So, you know, I could go into other ways, but instead, you know, if you weave it into a story, it somehow just sits with people better, I find. That's my opinion. And therefore, I have all these things that I wanted to talk about, but maybe people don't really want to listen because it's boring. You know, if you say, oh, so-and-so suffer from such and such illness and this, that, the other, and people go, oh, really, it's very depressing. I don't want to hear about it. Or if I said, I feel, for example, one of the characters that I made a little tribute to, Sonny Liston, whom I felt really, his story really stayed with me, which is he was a huge boxing heavyweight champion in the 60s.
Yeah.
And I want to talk about him a lot. I tell my friends, oh my God, you can't believe I came across this guy and this story. And, you know, can you imagine everyone just saying, oh, he's this dumb guy who can really box and he's a mafia? I said, but there's so much more to him. But by the way, he wants to listen to me.
Right.
So
right.
I think this book just really, in a way, almost summed up a whole lot of things I feel very strongly about. And I managed to package it nicely into a story and describe so many subjects that I feel very strongly about into a comprehensive tale. And I think that was my purpose.
So have you tried to take this to a traditional publisher?
I have. So I have gone through, I guess, the usual as a first-time author. I'm sure just like, you know, anybody in the arts industry who finds something for the first time, whether you're acting or a singer, you know, you realize that you're really a dime a dozen or maybe even less so.
Mm-hmm.
And you try and get some attention and you send off your query letters. So I've sent hundreds of letters to publishers, agents, and then most of them, no, actually all of them gave me the same answer, which is no.
Right.
So in the end, I just thought, oh, well, you know, it doesn't matter. I kind of went into this with my eyes wide open and knew that there's a higher chance that would happen. And so I'll give self-publishing a go. But I have to admit, I think there were some advantages I saw in self-publishing, which is you do, well, at least I have a lot of control because I did go through a few editors whom I hired on my own and had some feedback and modified the story along the way. And then in that process, I actually wondered if I went with a traditional publisher, how much of this would have made me change? For example, they may want the core character, the protagonist, to be a more mainstream character. They might have even asked me to change the gender. I would go, oh, maybe it's good that I did go with a traditional publisher. At least now I have full control over how I want to make this book.
Right.
And subsequently, after I publish and I start to market and publicize the book, I realized anyway that whether or not you have self-published or been published by a traditional publisher, there's a lot of work that I have to do on my own anyway to gain attention for the subject that I speak about.
That is true. Yeah, that is true.
So
definitely,
I realize ultimately there isn't a very huge difference except maybe financial way. I think my purpose anyway was never quite about, I certainly had no fantasy that I was going to write a book and became the next Rowling.
right. So I wanted to ask you about that book cover, because it really is striking. It's simple. I love the title, Girl Fighter, and then you've got the pictures of obviously a woman. You can't see her face, and she's wrapping up her hands. And I really think it sort of, I thought it was perfect. It certainly got my attention right off the bat. So did you do that yourself, or did you outsource that?
Oh, yeah, I'm so glad that you liked the cover, because the first one I did was a very plain one and fairly negative feedback, so I changed it to this one. I actually had someone to do the shoot. It was just in my local gym, I did do a bit of photo enhancement. And yes, as you said, the idea was, you can tell it's a fighter and you can tell it's a girl, but you can't see the face because I'd rather people not have a face to the character.
Yes.
I like them to imagine it themselves.
Yes.
So all you needed was it's a female fighter.
Right. Okay. Well, this has been really great. So, just to kind of finish up, what advice through this whole process? This has been your first book, and a self-publishing experience. What advice would you have to other writers who are either starting or maybe they've put out their first book as well? What can you give them through what you've learned through this process?
Well, in going back with the theme of the story, Girl and Fighter, you actually mentioned this just earlier, or you reacted to what I said earlier, and I actually really like what you said, how even though you find a struggle to like her, but you seem to, for some strange reason, want to root for her because she keeps fighting, and it's a spirit that it's very hard not to admire.
Right.
And going back to the theme of the book, actually, I kind of use the title as a double meaning, because when you first see the book, you think Girl Fighter, your first instinct is a female martial artist or combat sport athlete. But really, when you start to read the book, you realize it's actually, she's a girl and she's a real fighter in every sense of the word.
Yes.
So that's how the book was structured. And in a way, it translates to, I suppose, the advice, if I want to call it advice, a more suggestion. I don't tend to like to think of myself giving advice because there's too much responsibility. But more my personal experience is to write a book is almost really like a fight in a way. Because the first half of it was from having the idea to finishing the actual product or to finish the book or article or whatever it is. Mm-hmm. That itself is a first half of the journey, which is the discipline and the huge uncertainty of would anyone even like this? Is this even quality? You know, you battle with a huge amount of uncertainty because no one's ever read it. And you could, if you're writing a book, which is a very big project, it's very difficult to let someone read a chapter or a page and tell you how they think, because sometimes it takes the whole book before you can tell whether or not this piece of work has any quality. So it's a huge amount of uncertainty and darkness that you actually need to fight very, very hard to push that through.
Yes.
So once you finished it, and let's say, assuming it wasn't a piece of work that lacked quality that you have to either redo or restart, assuming that you finally push through the level of producing quality work, then you have to go through a second fight, which is acceptance or readership.
Right.
And that's another new level of the fight, because almost as though you finish the first round and you go, oh, this, thank God this is over, I finally finished writing, and you know, five people said it's a great piece of work so far, so I'm glad at least I didn't waste the last X number of years of my life. Time for me to rest. But no, actually it isn't. It's the second part of the second round. So now you have to go through a new different kind of fight, different rules and different game, and you need to re-strategize and recharge yourself and go through it again in a completely and utterly different way.
Right.
And until the point where, well, the definition of success or conclusion for the second round is a little bit different or a little bit harder to pinpoint, it's a bit more personal. Because you can't say, well, I finished the book now and this first phase is over. Second phase is, you know, what do you consider success? Do I have to earn back all the money that I spend in creating this piece of work as success? Mm-hmm. Or do I need to become, you know, independent or financially dependent? Or do I want a million viewers or readers? Or do I want it published in X number of countries? So that second half is a little bit more personal.
Right.
And but I suppose the underlying part is you can't give up and you just have to fight all the way through until you are happy with it.
Mm-hmm.
So you just need to work yourself towards that sort of stamina and energy.
Right. Well, this has been great. I really, really appreciate you taking the time to speak with me. And great job.
Thank you. And you're welcome.
All right. Okay, so thank you again. We will be in touch very soon. So have a great night. Thank you so much.
Okay. Thank you. You're welcome. And you have a great night, too.
Thank you. Take care. Bye-bye.